Penguin Random House Audio presents Juliet's School of Possibilities, a little story about the power of priorities. This is the author, Laura Vanderkam. Chapter 1. October's red and gold leaves blazed bright as Riley Jenkins drove south along the Garden State Parkway. Lovely enough, she thought, but even the fall colors failed to lift her mood. Nor could she summon the energy to be excited about her destination. Her firm's women's leadership retreat in the little town of Maras along the New Jersey coast. It wasn't that she resented working on a Saturday. Riley couldn't think of a Saturday she hadn't worked since landing her job with MB & Company, the consulting firm, after earning her Wharton MBA 4 years before. No, it was the opportunity cost of spending her Saturday with colleagues when she should be finding clients. After all, it was clients who got you ahead at MB, the most elite of all firms. It was clients who gave you power at this place she had long wanted to work. She remembered learning of its mystique in a casual conversation with a professor years ago, back when she'd been an undergrad at Indiana University, and waitressing to cover costs that her scholarship didn't. MB let you work with CEOs, prime ministers. You could solve their most important challenges and hence impact the world at a scale few other careers allowed. It didn't matter if you weren't yet 30 years old. You could earn copious cash while jetting around the world. In her first year, double what her staid Midwestern parents earned, combined at their peak. Stick it out to partner, and you'd take home millions. Riley prided herself on responding to clients as close to instantly as possible. In her four-year rise from star hire through project manager to an associate partner, she had rarely made clients wait more than an hour. She set up her phone to let her know when they emailed as she drove her rental cars around. Having grown up as a small-town Indiana girl, she still felt strange about hiring drivers. Her assistant knew not to book her on flights that didn't have internet access. But then, her mind zipped back to last week's showdown with her evaluator. Jean had guided her into that horrible beige conference room in the New York City office that she saw, thankfully, only when she wasn't at client sites. "Riley," she had begun. The older woman had kept taking her glasses off and rubbing her eyes. Riley soon understood why Jean was dreading this conversation. Riley was being put in the challenges bucket in MB's elaborate rating system. It was below average and only one step above resignation suggested. MB was too genteel to ever demand a resignation or the height of tawdriness, actually fire someone. Riley played the scene over and over in her mind as the exit numbers on the Garden State Parkway ticked down. "I have never been below average in my life," she told Jean. "Well, it's challenges for MB," Jean had said. "That doesn't mean you wouldn't be excellent somewhere else." Was that a threat? Riley didn't want to go anywhere else. She'd wanted to be an MB consultant with the same zeal with which her college roommate and best friend Skip had wanted to protest drone strikes. She couldn't imagine anywhere else offering this pace, this variety, and yes, this paycheck. "I don't get it," Riley had said. "I do everything the clients want. I get them just what they ask for, faster than they expect it." "Yes, yes." Jean had looked around that beige conference room, as if she thought someone might be spying on them. Then she lowered her voice. "Listen, Riley, here's the thing. You're 4 years in, newly in leadership. Everyone I interviewed said you're floundering in the role. But I'm..." she had started to protest. "Floundering?" Riley Jenkins did not flounder at anything. "Riley, listen to me. I am trying to help you here. Your upward feedback in particular was terrible. Your team members say you're so unfocused and distracted that they work around the clock, but they never know if they're working on the right things. Look, up until now, you could just do what the partners told you to, which you did." She had taken her glasses off again and searched for the right image. Finally, "You're like the world's most powerful drill. Point you at something, and you drill a hole instantly." "Okay." But at this level, you need to think about where the drill should go. And frankly, your clients and your colleagues don't see insight there. You need big ideas. Ideas your teams get excited about. Ideas the clients haven't even imagined. Ideas that you can suggest. So then they have to hire MB, right?
I see, Riley had said.
It's about the business case, Riley. Making partner is about being able to sell big ideas. Jean had suddenly glanced around, worried. Sorry, convince people that they need to engage MB to study your ideas. We don't use the word sell around here.
Of course.
That strange MB fussiness.
I will work on that.
Yes, she said. Please do. She sighed. Being in challenges means I need to document every 30 days that you are making real progress. If you're not, that's when other ratings come into play.
Riley had said nothing. Jean played her cards close, like the big players in the casino where Riley worked one summer years before. But she knew what this meant. If she hadn't made a sale in 30 days, she was out.
That had been a little over a week ago. The truth is, she had no idea how she was going to find space for brilliance. She couldn't not do what her clients and colleagues asked, and their demands already filled every available minute. They filled minutes that weren't available. She had been up so late the past few nights working on a proposal for her major client, a chain of extraordinarily hip cafes called the People's Coffee Shops, or PCS for short, that her brain could focus on little beyond finding time for a nap. She glanced at her phone's GPS. 15 miles until the turn. 30 minutes until she would arrive at this mysterious retreat location called Juliet's School of Possibilities, owned by the eponymous domestic maven. Riley had seen Juliet's TV shows occasionally in hotels when she was too stressed to sleep. How to host the perfect bridal shower. How to decorate a living room for $100. Apparently, she ran corporate retreats too. The women's leadership group of the Northeast U.S. offices had booked a weekend there to bond over cooking, crafts, and bike rides along the boardwalk. Riley wasn't sure how welcome she was. Nadia, a power player in the New York office, had said it was going to be just partners. Unfortunately, there were so few female partners at MB that they needed to dip down a level on the ladder to fill the retreat center and thus have the place to themselves. Riley, miffed at this, added it in as a reason not to go, along with a vague sense that she hadn't seen her boyfriend Neil in a while. A week? No, two. Three? It didn't seem possible that time had sped by so much since their last date. Pints at a beer garden, with Riley feeling more energized by every round of conversation with the brilliant entrepreneur. He had invited her to come meet his extended family soon. She had started daydreaming about Thanksgiving. Then Elsa, the chief marketing officer at PCS, mentioned being a fan of Juliet. Elsa moonlighted as a supermom to three boys in whatever time she wasn't shining a spotlight on the farmer who'd grown the wheat used in PCS scones. She proclaimed her jealousy that Riley got to go. It was the nicest thing Elsa had said to her the entire previous weekend. Riley and team had been cooped up with her for a miserable 2 days in another beige conference room, the weekend meeting happening because Elsa's husband and their boys were off camping with the Cub Scouts. Elsa had to meet with her CEO soon. Elsa had asked for ideas to bring to him. The team had flailed around in different directions all the following week before frantically cranking out a proposal to get it in by 9 p.m. Friday. This was right after Elsa's children went to bed, and hence when she looked at things. She wrapped up her emails by 11 p.m. That they hadn't heard anything by Saturday midday wasn't a good sign. After a few more minutes of stewing, "We must see progress in 30 days," Riley couldn't help herself. She dialed the manager on the proposed project. "Hey, Frank, it's Riley," she said. "You haven't heard from Elsa, have you?"
"Oh, hey," Frank said. He sounded like he'd just woken up. "I hadn't checked email yet this morning."
Riley seethed. It was almost noon. How irresponsible was that?
"Let me look."
"Oh."
"Oh?"
"Not good. She's reaching out to other consulting firms. This isn't what she's looking for.
Riley grabbed the second phone she kept so she could look at email while running other apps on her first phone.
She spotted an emergency pull-off.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.